hope you've learned a lot about education, particularly education in our state and what's working here and where we can go. I'm Nancy Kennedy, and I'm the director of the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute here at Furman. We are pleased to partner again for the sixth year with the Riley Institute to present this program. It's been a great partnership for Ollie, for the community, and just as a bonus for me, I've really enjoyed working with Jill Fusen, who puts this program together and finds all the speakers. So I would like to thank her for all of her work. So tonight we're going to hear about what happens after high school. We focused on primary and then school-aged children. So how is higher education going to respond as the population changes? What programs work to get students the skills and education they need to join the workforce? I'm looking forward to hearing more about this, and I hope you are too. And this is the perfect night for me to introduce this program, as the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute is all about learning beyond high school. Ollie at Furman's a diverse learning community of senior adults engaged in non-credit educational courses and programs. Many of you are members of Ollie, and we're glad you're here. If you're not a member and you're interested in hearing more, or if you have a friend or neighbor you think might be interested in knowing more about this program here at Furman, I would love to talk with you before you leave tonight. And now I'd like to welcome up Dr. Scott Henderson, who is going to get us started for this evening.
I also want to thank Ollie as well as the Riley Institute for hosting once again a marvelous series that has left, I think, all of us who've attended asking some important questions and coming up with at least some tentative answers. As Nancy indicated, we've spent the last couple of sessions talking about different aspects of K-12 student success. This evening, we are going to conform to a format that we've had pretty much for the last two sessions. Our first speaker is going to speak for about 35 minutes. We will then, and this is different for those of you who have been veteran attendees, we are going to take questions at that point for our first speaker. We will then have a short break. We are being treated this evening after break with a short video presentation that's highly relevant to what we've discussed so far. I will then ask our four snapshot presenters to come on stage. They will then provide three-minute overviews of some very important programs that they're running. And then I think I will exercise my executive authority and ask them some questions as a whole before we wrap up this evening's session. A couple of reminders. We ask that you turn off your cell phones unless you want to follow this session on Twitter, in which case you can actually participate, and if everything's going correctly, that should be right behind me, so you know what to do with that information. I have the pleasure of introducing our first speaker. This evening it is Dr. Michael Yuzdan. I don't have time to read all of his many accolades, but to give you an idea of his experiences in education, he was, from 1981 until 2001, the president of the Institute for Educational Leadership. From that time until the present, he has been a senior fellow of IEL. Before his participation in IEL, he was Connecticut's Commissioner of Higher Education from 1978 through 1981. He is the author of voluminous publications, books, and articles. He has been the consultant to many local and state boards and authorities. He has also participated in meetings in various capacities with educational policy here in the United States, China, India, Nepal, Hungary, Russia, and Japan. I'd like to add that I discovered this afternoon when I was able to have lunch with him that the one thing he and I share none of those accolades, but he is a former secondary social studies teacher. So we immediately bonded. And on that note, I will give the stage to him. Thank you.
It's a great pleasure to be here, particularly any function that is under the aegis of Dick Riley. I'm based in Washington now for 35 years. You'll forgive me for that. You know, the three great lies in American life, one is the check is in the mail, and secondly, I love you as much in the morning as I did last night, and then thirdly, I'm from Washington, I'm here to help. In any event, I hope I can be at least partially helpful. My assignment is essentially is to kind of talk about the kind of demographics that not only are affecting the state of North Carolina, where my son-in-law is from, South Carolina. And essentially, I want to break my comments actually into three sections, if you will. One would be very generally talking about the major demographic forces that are reshaping the United States, not only reshaping, but transforming our country. Secondly, to talk in greater detail about the situation in South Carolina, where the demographics are shifting radically as they are elsewhere. To make a very emphatic point, particularly in terms of demographics and higher ed, that kids just don't arrive at age 18. They basically spend their first 18 years in school with families, etc., etc. And the demographic changes that are so profoundly transforming the country, making it more diverse, provides challenges as well as opportunities. And when one is talking about higher ed or post-secondary education, the image that most of us have, and let me just say parenthetically, that obviously my gray hair empathizes greatly with an OSHA enterprise, because many of my neighbors, I live near Georgetown University, are delighted to participate in this kind of program, and particularly as we live in as septuagenarians, as octogenarians, and hopefully nonagenarians, I don't know what they call people who reach 100, this kind of program is going to be more and more significant. This wasn't an ad I was asked to give, but I just think it's wonderful. So post-secondary education now, most of people in this room, I assume, are pretty well educated. Most of us went to college between the ages of 18 and 22 and 23. And our image of college is a four-year undergraduate experience at a beautiful campus like Furman and so forth. This is a very small minority these days of the college attending population. It's maybe 12 or 15%. The norm of a college student is probably a mother age 28 or 29 attending a community college that basically to pick up a marketable skill. So when we're talking about college, we have to have a much broader conception than the four-year experience that I would guess 80 or 90% of the people in this room had. It's a different world. College is a different kind of world, and we have to distinguish between the various components of college. So I want to, the third thing I want to do, I want to talk about the general demographics of the country. Secondly, talk about South Carolina more explicitly. And thirdly, talk about the need, essentially, to rethink the way we organize and structure education in this country, where we have bifurcated higher ed and elementary and secondary education. And how do we begin to come up with mechanisms that will reconnect them? I'm an admirer of Noah's principle. He says we ought to begin, Noah, that's the guy who built the ark. We ought to begin to reward people who basically build the ark and not the people that predict the rain. Now, a guy like me is pretty good at predicting the rain, and the folks you'll hear from later are building the ark in terms of specific programs. And the reality is, and I wish some of our folks in Washington would have paid more attention to this wonderful citation from Walter Isaacson's book, The Innovators, that some of you may have read, where he says, vision without implementation is hallucination. And these folks are implementers, and are probably more important than the rhetoricians like myself. Let's start with the national. William Fry, a preeminent demographer at the Brookings Institute in Washington, identifies four broad trends that together are reshaping the country and will shape our future politics and culture. First is the one that is best known, the rapid growth among Hispanics, Asians, and multiracial populations. All are expected to double in size over the next 40 years, the result of immigration, higher birth rates among minority populations, people already here, and more interracial marriages. I will get back to interracial marriages later because it's a very interesting point about South Carolina that I didn't know until I did some homework. And we have to kind of recognize that our semantics have to change. What's majority and what's minority? And for the first time in history, essentially, the majority of kids attending public schools in the United States are minority kids. Now, I'm not much of a mathematician. In Washington, D.C., where I live, 85% of the kids in the public schools are of color. And we still call it a minority. We have to kind of rethink a lot of our semantics because the demographic changes are that consequential. So that's the first mentions. His book, incidentally, is called Diversity Explosion. You can get it from the Brookings Institute. I don't get a cut, but to fully understand the extent, and he covers the country in terms of a good deal about the South and South Carolina, as well as other sections of the country. The second broad trend is the declining growth rates and rapid aging of the white population. Some of us in this room may be particularly sensitive about that, but that's reality. The third trend is the continued growth of the black middle class and the migration among black Americans from north to south, reversing the historic south to north wave of migration in the 20th century. And I'll talk a little bit more about that again in the South Carolina context. And fourth, and most significant, is the fact that later in this century, there will be no majority demographic group in the United States. It'll all be kind of mixed up, if you will. So those are the basic national trends. Now, before I'll turn to South Carolina, and let me briefly mention some of the specific effects on South Carolina, then go on to more demographics about South Carolina. South Carolina, and I don't know the status of this, proposed stricter immigration laws recently, which is obviously a reflection of these demographic changes in terms of the impact on the political system. Secondly, South Carolina is part of the new Sun Belt, if you will, with immigrants and more African-American citizens coming from the North back to the South. Thirdly, and most interesting to me, was the blurring of racial boundaries. South Carolina, to my surprise, essentially had the highest growth of persons who identified themselves as white and black, meaning the growth of interracial marriages. And part of this is attributable to migration. Part of it is to people being freer to admit that it's this kind of a marriage. And basically, this is not a huge percentage of the population, but it's growing. And I think it augurs the future. Let's turn more explicitly now, because this was my basic assignment, and I don't want to get into trouble with Jill, so let me turn to it. In terms of the South Carolina demographics, much of this is based on a report from the Southern Regional Education Board, which is the most significant regional education board in the United States. It's a group based in Atlanta, Georgia, that represents 16 states from Texas clear up to Delaware, obviously including South Carolina. And these 16 states educate 38% of the kids in American public schools. I was talking earlier about community colleges and the ages of students and so forth, and the significance of basically a broader definition of what constitutes post-secondary education. In, again, according to SREB data, this was 2012 data, there were 12 four-year public institutions in the United States, I'm sorry, in South Carolina, 80,000 students. And there were 22-year public institutions, these are community and technical colleges, that educated 78,000. So the community colleges are playing an increasingly significant role, particularly with new populations, not only new populations, but you also have a trend in the United States, it's kind of an academic de-escalation. People are earning bachelor's and master's degrees and returning to community colleges to pick up marketable skills so they can get a job. Interesting and very important. And we don't quite treasure that kind of training. We still have an academic kind of pecking order, if you will. And most of us want our kids to go to four-year colleges. And yet, in many ways, kids are getting out of four-year colleges, and in this case, maybe your grandchildren or my grandchildren, and basically not finding jobs. So they're going into technical and STEM disciplines, science, technology, engineering, and math, largely in community colleges. And it's true of people that have bachelor's as well as master's degrees. And we have to respect that more than we do. John Gardner, who Mike will remember, was a wonderful Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare in the 1960s. And in his book, Excellence, wonderful, I wish I had the kind of way with words that John Gardner has, the society which scorns excellence in plumbing because plumbing is a humble activity and tolerates shoddiness in philosophy because it is an exalted activity, will have neither good plumbing or philosophy, because neither its pipes nor its theories will hold water. I wish I was smart enough to that it was original, but this is a lesson I think that has to be conveyed to the American public in light of the kind of technical training and so forth that's going to be necessary. The two-year schools, I'm not an expert in terms of the community or technical colleges in South Carolina. I'm an expert. I've been here for 5 hours, and I get on a plane tomorrow, and that's the end of my expertise. But my understanding is that the community and technical colleges here and the systems have been quite responsive to changes in the economy and so forth. That is not true throughout the country, where we have to spend much, much more attention to providing these institutions with the prestige and the very significant role they're going to play with new and old populations with a changing economy that's going to be so technologically and scientifically focused. And most of our post-traditional students will be older, members of minority groups or majority groups, the semantics again, have lower incomes, and all too frequently have inferior K-12 education. And in South Carolina, again, this is SREB data, of the total population, 3% have less than a ninth grade education, 9% have a ninth grade education up but no high school diploma, 30% are high school grads or equivalent, 21% have some college and no degree, and 17% have a bachelor's degree, and 9% have graduate or professional degrees. What I think is particularly significant here in light of the growing minority population is the fact that in terms of degree attainment, 42% of the white population, 24% of the African American population, 20% of the Hispanic population have basically either an associate's degree or a master's or bachelor's or higher degree. 2014 data, again, coming from SREB, the percentage of students eligible for reduced or free lunch. These are the students that aren't well fed at home, where the schools basically, in many cases, have to feed kids. And the numbers are staggering. The country at whole, on the whole, it's 45%. The SREB states it's 50%. In South Carolina, it's 53%. Or somebody said at dinner tonight, it may be up to 60%. It's obviously very high. And what are the implications of these youngsters that don't have opportunities, don't have enough food? It's going to be more and more of the workforce. So it's not only a moral question, it's an economic development, economic competitiveness question in the years ahead. The figures in terms of nationally, the African American students, these are in public schools, in the country at large, it's 16%. The SREB states, it's 23%. In South Carolina, it's 35%. So again, the implications of this for the attainment gap, for the future of the economy, the future of the state, et cetera, we've got to do things to strengthen and support the public schools, not just in education, but the other support services, social and health and so forth, that more and more kids and families are going to need in the years ahead. So now that I've sufficiently depressed you, and you all know the numbers, the differences between the median average of a South Carolina youngster with a bachelor's degree is approximately 57% higher than the median wage of a high school grad. Unemployment figures are much, much higher for non-high school grads and obviously lower for college grads. That's just common knowledge. Let me turn now to probably the most important part. What can we do about this bifurcation of the K-12 and post-secondary systems? Most well-educated Americans have absolutely no idea about the organization and structure of American education. Absolutely no idea. Even well-educated parents, they know where their kids are in school, they know the principal of their school, they know the teachers, they're interested. They have no idea what a school board does, what a school superintendent does, what the role of a state education department is. They even know less about how organized or disorganized post-secondary education is in most states. The reality is that these are separate governance structures in most states. Separate legislative committees determine their appropriations and so forth. And there's obviously has to be an interdependence here. Of course, post-secondary education is going to be very dependent on the quality of kids coming up the elementary and secondary system. And there's a little poem that, again, nothing I say is original, it's all derivative. But this is called Passing the Buck. The college professor says such rawness in a student is a shame, but high school preparation is to blame. The high school teacher remarks, from such youth I should be spared, they send them up so unprepared. The elementary teacher observes, a cover for the dunce's stool, why was he ever sent to school? The kindergarten teacher whispers, never such a lack of training did I see, what kind of person must the mother be? The mother replies, poor child, but he is not to blame, his father's folks were all the same. And this call passing the buck, and essentially there has to be much, much more independence between the system. It doesn't get enough attention at the highest levels. You'll hear from people who are doing exciting things, but they're episodic. They depend on individual leaders. And what we have to look to bring these kinds of efforts that you're going to hear from after I close my big mouth, essentially, it has to be institutionalized into governance structures. We need dual citizenship between K-12 and higher education. And projecting and moving this issue is going to be extremely difficult. You know, everybody's for change unless it affects them. And what's going to happen and kind of close political systems of K-12 and higher ed, it's going to have to be prodded by the business community and the political community in some manner, shape, or form. And this issue is invisible in the United States, the need to connect the two systems. About 10 or 12, 15 years ago, a bunch of governors, and maybe it happened in here, I don't know, created P16 councils, where they would try to get the educational policymakers from preschool, and if they made me go out tomorrow, which is extremely unlikely, I would invest very heavily in preschool, and I think a number of your sessions have focused. This is where you get the biggest bang for your buck. And these P16 councils, new governors came in, the P16 councils disappeared, and the issue does not have the kind of traction it needs. So I kind of take every opportunity I have to kind of push it. We need it because more kids need special help if they're going to get into post-secondary education with the diversity of students. The standards movement, and I understand as of 2015 or 16, all the kids have to take the ACT test now in South Carolina. That's long in coming. It should have happened a long time ago. Teacher education is an issue that obviously impacts K-12 and higher ed. Our teachers are prepared in post-secondary institutions. Remedial education, kids are getting to community colleges, and I don't know, the remedial rates might 50, 60%. Even the four-year colleges all over the country, the remedial rate is 40. So we're paying twice in terms of the taxpayers. So that's another thing that reason for reassessing the relationship or lack of relationship. International economic competition the workforce needs in terms of global competition, and on and on and on. And so the country and South Carolina face enormous demographic challenges as well as opportunities. We have in post-secondary education, the focus at long last is beginning to turn to success and not just access in terms of student achievement and student outcomes. States have to appropriate statewide exams. What's happened in states throughout the country, each college has its own admission standards, so kids get out of different high schools and get to college and find out that their high school experience was not congruent at all with their college experience. We have to expand dual enrollment programs that some of our folks are very much involved in. You'll hear about the specifics later. Accountability systems. We have to revamp federal aid and foundation aid to provide incentives for K-16 articulation. And that's all I'm going to say. If there are questions or responses, I'd be pleased to take them. For some miracle, I think I'm within my time constraint, Scott. This is unusual. I'm rusty.
Uh-huh. Well, that will give our audience all the more time to pin you to the ground. I know this person.
I get a microphone, too.
Yes.
Well, I'm a very historical person in education in South Carolina because I've been around here for a long time and worked in a large high school for 35 years in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And under the leadership of Governor Riley and the changes that began in the 1980s, I think South Carolina's come a long way in terms of encouraging students and working with them to have that connection between, I worked in a high school, so between high school and college with dual enrollment, school to work. Lots of different initiatives like that. But I just wondered, is there a state in the United States or an area of the United States that you could point to that you think have done an outstanding job in helping students make that transition from K-12 into not just secondary education, but careers in secondary and post-secondary education?
Probably I would cite California. What California did, they had huge, huge remedial rates of kids leaving high school going into the four-year state colleges. California has a tiered system. The University of California and its campuses admit the top 8%, the state colleges the top third, and so forth, and it had a huge remediation piece. The senior year in high school, in most cases, in many cases, I should qualify that, essentially is a waste of time. The kids go into four-year colleges after the first couple of months, they've applied, they get into college, and they worry about the prom the rest of their senior year. But what they did with, particularly with the kind of demographic changes that California has had, what they did in the 10th grade was to coordinate between the school system, the state education department, and the state college system to provide an exam that basically would test where the kids were in the 10th and 11th grades, so that by the time the kids entered the 12th grade, they would have a sense of the kind of remedial work they would need, so that the 12th grade, instead of being a waste of time, these kids were being prepped in English and mathematics and so forth, so that their skills would be more congruent with what the university required. That, to me, is very important. And I think SREB is trying to move that agenda, if you will, or to have the various states consider that similar strategy. I mean, in many ways, it has to be a lot earlier than the 10th or 11th grade. And as an educator, the earlier the intervention, obviously, the better and more effective it'll be.
Other questions from our audience members?
God, you couldn't all have agreed with me. That's never happened.
During your speech, you referenced this dilemma of episodic solutions and successes. And I have to admit, this is my third session, despite all the brilliant stories that have been shared, there you leave the room thinking, how is that going to be brought to scale? And what are the parameters of federal funding on a program that is really only operating in a small geography? And then if you reflect on Common Core curriculum, and some of those umbrella programs that may be better known to the lay people in this room. It just seems that there's just such a rejection for numerous political reasons that we may not want to get into. But how do you address that? How do you find the solutions and bring them to scale if it's working well? If it has federal funding, why isn't it required to be rolled out nationally?
Yeah.
Being in D.C., how does that work?
Well, the federal funding, the feds have shot their wad. In many ways, the tragedy of the Common Core was that the federal government overreached. It was essentially a state-based program generated by the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. And then the feds got involved and played into the hands of lots of people around the United States who essentially are committed to local and state control of American education, whether one agrees with it or disagrees with it. Those roots are very deep. You know, we have 13,000 school boards in the United States. Local control is almost a theology in this country. People make their fundamental lifestyle decisions, how far they're going to commute or where they're going to live, not on the basis of whether a community has a world-class mosquito abatement district or fire department. Schools drive everything. And the current administration, I think, basically did not have an understanding of how deep local and state control of education is. It's part of our culture and our educational policy system. And unfortunately, you know, the politics of it, essentially, the feds have shot their wad. And even at the zenith of the Great Society, I'm dating myself, not the Great Society, the zenith of the federal role, the federal share of support for elementary and secondary education for K-12 has never been higher than 12 or 13%. For most of our history, it's 4%. And the political problem essentially was that the level of government, the feds, who only supported education, well, in the last decade or two, maybe to the tune of 8 or 10%, were demanding 100% of the accountability. And that doesn't make sense politically. That political equation doesn't work. And so there's been this incredible backlash among Democrats as well as Republicans in terms of the federal overreach. So the feds aren't going to be very helpful here. They can provide some little incentive monies and so forth. The action is now at the local and state level. And there are real questions as to the capacity at the local and state level, but that's another issue. Your question about scale is right on. And that's why, in order to have any sense of scalability, the four programs that you'll be hearing about in the second part of the program depends on inspired individual leaders. There isn't government or institutional support for it. And when these leaders move on, these programs too often just disappear. Of course, they're not institutionalized. And that's why I'm saying that I would love to see activity by the business and political communities to create and insist upon more interaction between K-12 and post-secondary education, you know, at the state level, because that's where the action's going to be. The problems of scalability are massive. The Gates Foundation tried to do it in the last decade or so, or 15 years ago, and it's become so terribly and dysfunctionally politicized that I'm not optimistic that we can dig our way out. Now, the Common Core made all kinds of sense. I mean, you know, there shouldn't be North Dakota mathematics or South Carolina English. But the feds botched it terribly. And I happen to be a Democrat, but they botched it. And some of us tried to forewarn them, but they didn't listen. So there was a good deal of arrogance involved in all of that. One of the nice things about being retired is that I can say whatever the hell I want. There's one over there, stuff.
I forgot her. Okay, yes. We'll bring you back here, and then we'll come up.
We're back in the bleachers.
Given that the typical student is 28 to 35, adult working, what do you see as the most significant or impactful systemic structural changes that four-year institutions need to make in order to accommodate that?
Well, I'm not sure the four-year institutions. Essentially, many of them now have, essentially many states have separate structures, governance structures. Connecticut had that. The two-year institutions had its governance structure. I'm talking about publics, you know, and Furman's a private institution. They have a separate structure for career and a governance structure, a separate board and so forth. And what's begun to happen as the demographics have shifted, there's more and more easily transfer or admissions after community colleges. You can move into a four-year college if you want to go ahead and with the bachelor's academic track. Probably the best thing that could happen would be changes in student aid, which basically are geared and predicated on the needs of full-time students who are the college kids. When I was 19, 22, I mean, and how do they begin to devise student aid programs that will accommodate to these, the new majority, if you will, of the people who are going to community colleges, are working part-time, single mothers, et cetera, you know, who are struggling. And so the student aid piece, I think there's growing transferability between the systems that's going on in a lot of states. One of the difficulties of American education, it is so fragmented and decentralized, and I think it's true of both post-secondary and K-12, that whatever you say about it is true or false, it depends where you look. But I think the student aid issue would be to revise student aid to accommodate the needs of this new non-traditional, non, you know, 19 to 22-year-old age group.
Hi. You spoke quite a bit about the disconnect between K-12 and higher education and building the bridge between the two, and that's definitely an issue that I personally have studied quite a bit, and it's very interesting to me that I look at one of the biggest challenges is within K-12 is just the way that students are able to learn. And I feel like with K-12 teachers, they're so passionate about their subject, and very often they have to spend their time every day fitting within the parameters to prepare for testing. And then students go off to higher education, and for the first time, the expectation is for critical thinking, is for the opportunity to open your mind and open your heart towards a passion, towards a subject in a way that you didn't have time for necessarily in high school. I love the speakers that are here tonight, and I know they're going to talk a lot about the bridge programs, even in Greenville County, and we do a lot around programming of exposure, and you talked about challenges with students not knowing about kind of that next step of higher ed. But I'd love to hear your opinion on kind of the way of thought and the difference in the way that students learn between K-12 and higher education, and any recommendations from your experience of how we can better build that bridge intellectually for students.
Well, I haven't been in a classroom in a long, long time, so I wouldn't have any particular expertise there. But I think the testing movement, which was so excessive for so long, is being curbed. I mean, we need testing. You do need a modicum of testing, but it became so excessive that it's driven lots of wonderful teachers out of K-12 education because they didn't want to be automatons. You know, they wanted to be in a position to be creative and imaginative and so forth. I think that piece will encourage. You know, my own sense is project-based learning. I mean, in terms of relevance instead of traditional time. I mean, it's a different world. I don't begin to understand the technology. I depend on my grandchildren for learning how to do anything. An iPhone, an email. I'm kind of a late bloomer in technology. But it's a different world. The kids have access to information. You know, they're all on their machines all the time. Maybe our generation is beginning to get on the machines all the time. And so I think we have to shift our modes of instruction
You know, where teachers are facilitators, they're resource people, and you don't have the traditional didactic, you know, the teacher just, you know, providing 40 minutes of information and so forth. Because it's a different world, and I think certainly the technology. And the reality is that some brilliant educational researcher once figured out by the time a kid is 18, he or she spends only about 8 or 9% of their time in the formal school setting, and that 85 or 90% of the time plus is spent in the larger world. It's sleeping, it's with the family, increasingly it's on the internet, it's on their gadgets, it's mauling, M-A-L-L-I-N-G, whatever, you know. And so the schools remain singularly important, but there are so many other significant educative forces in kids' lives now. You know, largely, you know, the technology, their access to information, Google, Safari. See how versed I am? It's impressive. Don't go beyond those two words, I'm in trouble. But, you know, it's a different world, and have we adapted to that world, and have teacher education institutions adapted? You know, Scott would be in a better position to answer that than I am.
Actually, we're going to go to someone else as I escape that.
My question is in regards to how scholar practitioners can help. I mean, we see this long game, right? We understand that this P16 bridge is super important. How can we help convince the general population and local governments and business leaders that adopting maybe an improvement science approach or systems theory like the Mellon Foundation is doing with network improvement communities to kind of tackle these issues before we really try to scale it up like we do everything else in education? How can we kind of convey the message that it's not just about, you know, the Michelle Ray point of view of I don't have time to wait because it's my kid in the school, but we need to kind of have schools be maybe a little bit of a laboratory for the next 10, 20, 30 years while we figure out kind of best practices and best methods nationwide? Because in South Carolina, maybe a statewide approach would work, but South Carolina politics kind of shies away from that.
Well, you know, my own sense is that the whole society has a collective stake in this. Largely, you know, the shifting demographics, where's the workforce going to come from in the next 20, 30, 40 years, and to support the economy and so forth. And my own sense is that school people have to break out of their historical, cultural, institutional isolation from the larger world, that indeed education is much more than schooling, as significant as schooling is, and they have to reach out more proactively to political and business leaders and so forth in working with them. And again, I don't blame the school people. We've created, again, a governance structure where in most states, school board elections are held at a different time than general purpose elections, you know, where you elect presidents and governors and town councils and so forth in November. And most states elect their school boards in April or May. And so there's a detachment from general purpose government, and I'm not saying schools should become political in the partisan sense. I'm saying that these problems are so serious, the stakes are so high in terms of the future of the country, that school people should reach out more than they do in terms of an institution that's basically been isolated from the political mainstream.
If you look at a lot of the lists that come out as far as our ranking as a country for science or math, et cetera, we don't do too well. You mentioned that you have consulted with, I don't know, 10 different countries. Have we ever given any consideration to looking at the solutions that other countries have that get them on this list that's 20 or 20 positions above us? And there was a movie that I saw called which country do we invade next? It was a satirical, but in any case, they showed several countries' education systems in Norway and some of the other Scandinavian countries that seem to have good ideas. Do we ever reach out and try to see if maybe something that somebody else does is benefit?
Well, sure,
is helpful?
Sure we do. Finland's been the role model. Virtually everybody I know other than myself has been to Finland now. And it's a very homogeneous society. It's small. Most countries have very centralized educational systems, ministries of education and national capitals that determine teacher salaries, determine the curriculum, and it has some advantages. I mean, depending on how enlightened the leadership is at any given time, because if they want STEM, and the country needs STEM and needs engineers and technicians and so forth, they can push it that way. And it happens that way in places like India, where they basically have all kinds of technological institutions. That's not our culture here. The problem is that, you know, we have organized. I mean, the South has a better sense of opportunity in many ways because you have county school districts and some city school districts as well, but that you have general purpose government and school governance meshed in a county organization. You go up north into Ohio or Pennsylvania or New York or New Jersey, you got thousands of school districts that are not coterminous with general purpose government. So centralization, you know, it's enlightened despotism in a way. It has advantages as well as disadvantages. And, you know, the countries that, you know, have been successful in STEM and so forth, the grass is always greener. I remember after A Nation at Risk was published, there were enough gray hairs in the room to remember that in 1983. It was a study commissioned by the federal government. It was during the Reagan administration, where they said the weakness of the American schools was tantamount to unilateral disarmament. The Japanese and Germans in the early 80s were cleaning our clocks. We had 15% inflation. Interest rates were 12 or 13%. And there was a lot of pressure, you know, on the schools, and that's when the business and political communities became involved. And Southern governors were in the vanguard of this, recognizing, you know, it was Riley here and Bill Clinton in Arkansas and Jim Hunt in North Carolina and Lamar Alexander in Tennessee. They saw the link between education and economic development. And they were largely responsible for the fact that the South has made so much progress, you know, in recent years. I'm not getting into the current political situation. That's above my pay grade here. But essentially, our problem, decentralization has advantages and disadvantages. I was over in Japan a couple of years ago, right after A Nation at Risk. It wasn't a couple of years ago. It was a couple of decades ago. And I expected the Japanese essentially to be so happy with their system. Finland's been the more recent model, but it was Japan was doing everything right. And I was stunned to find out that they looked at our system as being much better because it was more creative, imaginative, and their kids were doing well on tests, but it was just rote learning. So in many ways, we need some kind of amalgam of centralization and decentralization. And sure, we have led the German apprentice system has been very successful in generating, you know, Germany's remarkable economic progress. There are programs around that model it, but again, getting back to this lady's question, it's a scalability issue. How do we get it to scale? And it's very hard to get it to scale. 14,000 school districts, or 13,000 now, 100,000 foxholes called schools, 50 state education departments, most of them singularly underfunded and lacking capacity. And it's such a fragmented and decentralized system that everybody's involved, and you know, how do you move it? And, you know, this past administration, or the current administration, I should say, tried through centralization, and they had many good ideas, but they forgot about the basic political structure of American governance in terms of schools. So
we've got time for one more brief question in the front here.
My name's Janet. I think that maybe I'm asking too specific a question for you, but with the idea of mature adults going back to school to get skills, I like the idea of the auto mechanic programs that I've seen at the community college, where you can take units and people can go back for just a unit. Do you have any idea why in community colleges it seems like there's a push for completing programs? Why can't people just sign up for a skill?
A certificate program, or this is less than a certificate program. It's an I don't know the answer to that. Mike only has 3 minutes.
They do that.
In too many cases, the community colleges have been trying to ape the four-year colleges, and essentially, too worried about traditional academic prestige and aren't really meeting. Again, you can't generalize.
Well, I would like for us to take the opportunity to once again thank our speaker, Dr. Michael Uzdan, for a wonderful presentation. We received a link to a local television news story that many of us had an opportunity to preview, and we're going to share that with you this evening. And our rationale is quite simple. In this approximately 4 minute long video, you will see many of the themes, many of the challenges, but many of the success stories that we've covered encapsulated in the story of one young man. And you heard me say local. It is local news. And that reminds us that our transition this evening will be to hearing about some local programs that are addressing the concerns raised tonight and in our previous sessions. So let's watch this good summary of what we've been discussing. I'll sit back here.
Graduation, a celebration. Even more so when you're the first male in your family to graduate from high school.
Hard work pays off, and this moment, it's feeling pretty good right now.
Many call what Greenville High's Davis Kirby has accomplished a miracle.
They can make a movie out of it, and people would say, yeah, that's not true. There's a lot of fiction involved.
When Davis was in third grade, he started coming here to the Frazee Center in Greenville.
What is the new number when we round it to the nearest 10?
An after-school program working with children in poverty, run by Matt and Jenny Reeves.
Immediately, we see that Davis is just unbelievably talented academically. He just gets everything he reads.
Davis, the game is Moss. Get it. Oh, nice.
And they quickly learned of his more than just humble beginnings. Davis was born in a Columbia prison where his mother was incarcerated.
I look back and I'm like, wow, you know, it's hard to go without your real parents. And I did it for the majority of the younger parts of my life.
His father has never been in his life, so it was his grandparents, 27 years removed from having their fourth child, who picked Davis up from prison when he was 2 days old.
He wasn't even named. There's a lot I had to learn that I had forgotten.
Frankie and Garfield Jenkins have been a steady influence in his life.
Yeah, I couldn't miss that.
Who by chance just happened to live near the Frazee Center. Davis was actually one of the first students to come to Frazee in 2006, and he also hung around during his middle school years. But in eighth grade, a major loss, a very close relative, a mentor, sent to prison for conspiracy to distribute cocaine.
Probably one of the darker moments of my life, because this is someone who was a role model for me up to that point, and then you know, when someone's taken away from you, you know, abruptly, it's hard to deal with that.
Show them your shot.
Jay Rajay is the drug enforcement agent who put that close relative away and honored his request.
Get
to check up on Davis.
Woo. I said, you know, I'll check up on him from time to time. And he said, you know, I'd appreciate that. I would if you'd look in on him.
So Rajay did. And for obvious reasons, it was awkward at first. Then things clicked.
He's been a friend. He's been a mentor to me. We work out together. He beats me in basketball. We go out to eat.
You should be working on your homework.
Then another major leg up for Davis. A Furman student, Brittany Waldrip, began interning at the Frazee Center, recognized Davis's vast potential, and helped get him an interview with the Furman program Bridges to a Brighter Future for students whose potential outdistances their circumstances. Davis was chosen.
I started freaking out and screaming.
Davis says the program changed every aspect of his life.
Not really a shy person anymore. I probably talk too much now.
And with his confidence soaring, he sent applications to some of the most revered universities in the nation.
He called me and he said, Stanford denied me. And then he said, Duke said no. Georgetown passed.
Then came North Carolina Chapel Hill, the answer yes to UNC on an academic scholarship.
Words can't describe my feelings for going into my freshman year of college.
And there's more to celebrate. His close relative and mother are both out of prison and both have jobs.
And I'm proud. I'm proud for him. I'm proud to see him go to college.
He broke the cycle. He broke it. Davis has been the one who's made decision after decision after decision that are right.
Davis Kirby plans to pursue either a political science or computer science degree.
My only closing comment on that is the first time I saw this, what occurred to me was Davis talks about the individuals who have been role models or mentors in his life. And what you figure out by the end of that story is that he is now the role model and the mentor for others. On that positive note, I would like to ask our four snapshot speakers to please take their seats on the stage. And once they're up there, I will introduce them and they will speak in that order. We are very pleased to have with us this evening Pam Davis, who is the director of Bridges to a Brighter Future, which you just heard about in the news story. We have Julio Hernandez, who is the Greenville Technical College's Northwest Campus Director. We have Mike Murphy, who is the former president of Lee College. And we have Brenda Timms, who is the Vice President of Academic and Faculty Affairs, GHS Clinical University of the Greenville Health System.
Good evening. So right now, as I speak, we have 77 high school students just along the way here at Furman in Johns Hall. They are taking a life skills workshop tonight. They're learning how to change a flat tire. They're learning how to present themselves professionally, and they're learning how to appropriately use social media. This is just one of the workshops that these students will be engaged in over the next 4 weeks while they're here at Furman University. These students make up 19 Greenville County public high schools and charter schools, and they meet the following criteria. They all are from low-income families. They are on track to be the first in their family to go to college. They all have a 3.0 or higher and they have a clean disciplinary record, and if that's not impressive enough, they all have a determination and a motivation and this what we call grit to go to college and to break the cycle of poverty. Bridges to a Brighter Future, we're celebrating our 20th year this year. We're very excited about that. It's an intense 7-year college access and success program right here at Furman University. As I mentioned, we do select students at the end of their 9th grade year, and we support them all the way through college graduation. So obviously the way we support a sophomore in high school may look a little different than how we're supporting a junior in college, but nonetheless, we're giving them the tools that they need to be successful in life. There are three main components to Bridges to a Brighter Future. There's the Bridges Foundations program, which is the 4-week summer program that our students attend for 3 consecutive summers while they're in high school. There's also Saturday College, which is 1 Saturday a month during the school year. So from September through April, they come here to Furman on Saturday to get academic support. We do lunch and learns, life skills. We also engage in a social activity in the afternoons. We also have a third component that's called Crossing the Bridge. So as our students are beginning that transition from high school to college, Davis being one of those, we're providing them that support as they transition. So as they're from the beginning, as they're starting their application process, working through financial aid, scholarships, navigating through this very overwhelming process, we're right there to support them through that. That support doesn't end. We also are very much in their lives all the way through their freshman year and beyond. Typically, by their sophomore, junior year, the need for us is a little less because they've started to find the resources on their own campus, but we're still there. Through Crossing the Bridge, there's also a 1-week program on Furman's campus. So just last week, I got to spend a week with Davis. He was right here. We spend that week providing them with workshops and I would say tools, but we're really just sharpening the tools that they've been getting all these years so that they are fully prepared for college in that next step. As you can imagine, college is overwhelming, and being a first-gen student, the first person in their family to go to college can be extremely overwhelming, and they can feel some culture shock. So we're trying to prepare them for that and really look at what are the resources on their college campus that they can find once they get there. We will be visiting them at least twice a year, but we want them to be sure that they have what they need on their campus once they get there. I'm not sure how much more time I have. I know that they were okay. So that's a good nutshell. So thank you.
Good evening. My name is Julia Hernandez. I'm a Greenville Technical College Northwest Campus Director. At Greenville Technical College, we believe that it's very important that our entire community have access to education as much as possible and provide them the tools to be successful, because we really believe that when we do that, it's gonna drive personal and economic growth here in our community and in South Carolina. And so we wanna ensure that our entire community has access to education, our veteran population, our traditional students, our non-traditional students, and including our growing DACA population. That's right, DACA, D-A-C-A, Deferred Action Childhood Arrival. These are young people that were brought to the United States before their 16th birthday, in many cases at age 1. They started the elementary here with us, elementary schools, went to middle school, high school, and some have graduated. These young people can work here and can go to school anywhere, but because of their residency, can't qualify for any federal funding, any state funding, or in some states, they can provide state funding, but here in South Carolina, not necessarily. Some states provide in-state tuition. In South Carolina, they don't provide they provide out-of-state tuition. We charge out-of-state tuition. And one more thing, a lot of our young people here in South Carolina are not able to get these professional licenses such as cosmetology or nursing or massage therapy. So it's no surprise that sometimes when I go to a school such as Wade Hampton High School and I talk to a junior who was in junior in April, he speaks 3 languages, German, Spanish, and English. He has engineering class, calculus class, these are all college classes, his junior year. And when I look at his report card, his lowest grade is lower than a 97. And he's concerned that he won't be able to go to college next year, and we'll keep on talking. Or with a young lady at Hillcrest High School when she graduated this past year, she cried at graduation because she wants to be a nurse. She's bilingual, but even if the parents can pay out of pocket, that out-of-state tuition is pretty high, And of course, she can't get the license, even if she had all the money in the world. My job is not to depress you either. There's a lot of good things going on in South Carolina. Greenville Technical College is very innovative, and through the collaboration that we have with Greenville County Schools, great leader, and Hispanic Alliance, and a lot of nonprofit organizations. What we do, we provide through lunch and learns, where we go into the high schools and we have conversations with these young people and say, okay, we know that you want to be a trained workforce here in South Carolina. We know that you want to contribute here in South Carolina. Well, these are some of the fields or programs that maybe you can qualify. And let's go take another step further. Let's look at some of the federal funding out there that's available for you, some national scholarships in particular, or we start looking at a lot of the local scholarships. So we're trying to create access and success. And as a result, 2 years ago at Greenville Technical College, when it came to our Hispanic community, we had 3%, and while Greenville County had 9%, 2 years later now, Greenville Technical College has 8% of Hispanic students in higher education. So as it's been said, never doubt a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens that want to change the world, because in the end, that's all that it has. So we encourage you to collaborate with Greenville Technical College and a lot of universities as we all together take ownership of our community success.
Good evening. Can I see the next slide? Thank you. I want to do three things. We seem to be doing everything in three tonight, so I'll just continue the trend. The first is to talk to you a little bit about this photo up here and some of the obvious and perhaps not so obvious aspects of it, the implications for South Carolina, and how these implications can be addressed in ways that serve our state and our communities, perhaps less in a less costly fashion than we presently do. If you look at that photo, I think you see that this is a graduation exercise. It's all male. There's a reason for that. That'll become obvious in a minute if you don't already know. These are just young and middle-aged men completing college. What's unique about this is it's done within the walls of the Huntsville Penitentiary in outside of Houston, Texas. These are all men who have been incarcerated and may well be incarcerated for many years. For the last 50 years, Lee College, where I served as president, I didn't serve that long, used to bother me that Mike, every time he mentioned old folks, he looked at me in his comments. I'm sure he was just a coincidence. But what we have here is an unusual set of circumstances where 50 years ago, the state of Texas, not always considered soft on crime by most analyses, decided that it was worth the investment in this program, and it's been existing for 50 years since. This happens to be a small group of the 100 who graduated with associate and certificate degrees this past year. So that's pretty obvious. What's less obvious is that this group of people actually outperforms traditional community college students when it comes to graduation rates. And the reason for that, if you've been in other sessions, is time on task. They have time. We often talk about people who are incarcerated doing time. We're talking about them as using time. And that's where we make an attempt to differentiate. If you attended last summer, you heard some comments, some excellent progress that's being made with the commitment of a whole bunch of people in the areas of correction reform. And a meta-analysis, if you're not familiar with the term, a meta-analysis is a study of studies. And 30 states were involved in this meta-analysis by the RAND Corporation under the auspices of the Department of Justice. And what they found was that programs like this have a huge impact already, a huge impact on reducing recidivism. In South Carolina, 1 in 4 released prisoners will return in 3 years, and 1 in 3 will return in 5 years. There is a good reason for not wanting these men and women to come back, not the least of which is that the video you just saw, a mother in prison, a child out. 2/3 of the men and 3/4 of the women in prison have children. So they're left with hopefully some caretaker who will cover their needs for at least that period of time. I want to suggest that South Carolina, and something that I've been working on for the last year, is replicate this program. None exists. There are 20,000 men and women in South Carolina prisons, only the South Carolina prisons, not the federal prisons or the community prisons, the state prisons. And they spend $20,000 a year to keep a person in prison. And that's a hell of a lot more than they're spending on public education per year for a child. So let's get them out of there and back into their communities and functioning productively. And this is a way to do it. Thank you.
Good evening. We'll keep the theme of three going. So I'm going to, through my presentation, talk to you about the why. This is the why slide. So I'm with the Greenville Health System, where I'm not with academic. I'm an academic brat. I've been in academia most of my career. But I have the good fortune now to be on the workforce side and in the healthcare system. This is the why for the program I'm going to share a little bit more in detail with you this evening. As we think about the healthcare world, it's changing so rapidly. The workforce is changing even more rapidly. We believe that we have to address the shortages in the workforce, retool the ones who are currently there, but more importantly, how do we really begin to tap into that future generation to begin to prepare them for the healthcare system of the future? The next slide will show you how we're doing this. So I know this is busy. I don't expect you to read it. However, I want you to know we have a plan. There's a method to our madness, right? And so this is our workforce strategy. You've been learning in the other sessions about K-12. Well, we do a lot in the health system with that K-12 pipeline. Tonight specifically, though, go to the red. The red is our Medical Experience Academy, Medex Academy, we call it. We launched that program in 2010, summer of 2010. But what I want to tell you about Medex Academy is that this program is our pipeline. Now, it's our pipeline to our medical school, yes, but it's the pipeline to the healthcare workforce, all healthcare careers. Most young people don't have a clue as to what the job opportunities are. We hire in every field you can imagine. We try to expose young people to what those opportunities are while they're in their academic institution, be it high school or college. Medex Academy has four tiers. Tier one are those rising high school seniors in high school. If you go across to the next column under undergraduate, you'll see that you'll see Medex Academy tiers 2, 3, and 4. Tier two are those freshmen and rising sophomores in college. Tier three are those sophomores and rising juniors in college. And tier four are rising seniors in college. We believe, as a health system, we must partner with our academic institutions and create a robust pipeline. That's why you see that continuum. It is a pipeline. While the program I'm talking about tonight, Medex Academy, is for those rising seniors in high school and undergrads, we know we've got to have people working in the pipeline, what you've been learning about in some of the earlier sessions. Medex Academy, I want to finish my session by telling you a little bit about Medex through telling a young lady's story. Her name is Kelsey. As I mentioned, we started this program in summer of 2010. We started the program with 12 students, 11 from Carolina High Academy. These are rising seniors in high school, and one from Southside High. That was Kelsey. Kelsey desired to be a physician. Kelsey came from a family. She was very academically strong, but she came from a family with not a lot of support. So we met her in summer of 2010, and just to fast forward, she graduated high school, went on to USC, majored in biology, pre-med, on track, academically doing great. Because she was so smart, she was able to graduate a year early. But because Medex Academy is not just a program, it truly is a relationship, we stayed in contact with Kelsey. Kelsey did all four tiers every summer. Those students are there for 6 weeks, the undergrads are. We found out about Kelsey, well, she stayed in contact. She was going to graduate early. She was not ready for medical school. Sharp student. Great GPA, MCAT score was not good. She didn't have the clinical experiences that she needed, or they weren't documented. And so we needed to do some work with her. Kelsey, we advised her to stay in school one more year, and she did. Kelsey has just completed her first year at USC School of Medicine, Greenville. She is a rising M2. And in the midst of all of this, when the economy went south, her dad lost his job. Okay, so there was a lot of community support around here. My message to you is that we have tremendously bright young people living in our communities, but we must recognize that that they can be academically strong but still get tripped up and not have a career that they love and fulfill a workforce need if we don't wrap the other supports around them. We have tremendous partners in this program. I see my friend John Beckford down back there. Furman is a tremendous partner in Medex Academy, Clemson University, and University of South Carolina. We're all great partners trying to work together to figure out how we close this gap. Okay, thank you.
Excuse me. As promised, I would like to pose a couple of questions to the entire panel of our snapshot speakers. Not each of you should feel obligated to respond, but that will be held against you. What occurred to me as I was listening to the four of you speak is that we have just finished going, that was wishful thinking, we are in the midst of a campaign for President of the United States. And yet, on both sides of the political divide, we've heard virtually nothing about education. So what I want the four of you to do is to imagine we have now elected the new president. What one thing, and you can think as big as you want, this is a wish list, what one thing would you tell him or her? What one thing would you ask them to do in regard to education? We're going to assume that he or she has the power to make that happen.
Okay, you want me to start, Mike? Okay. One of the things I would recommend is that to bring the education leaders and the business community in the same room together. I think so often it's easy to get siloed in the worlds we work in or that we go to work in every day and forget the end game. Students who are going to school, be it K-12 or higher ed, ultimately they want a job, they want a career that they're going to love. And I just think a robust conversation with the business community would be very valuable.
Great.
I would tell them to forget free tuition for community colleges. See, I'm retired like Mike and I can say whatever I want. And focus on early childhood, preschool. Mm.
I wanted to add something. With a lot of the families that I work with, doing something regarding, you know, immigration reform, you know, you have some of the most brightest students here in this area. They're smart, they're rock stars. You know, the only thing preventing them is an education sometimes, and obviously we try to eliminate those barriers, but one of those barriers is financial, and when they have to pay out-of-state tuition, while some states they have to pay in-state. I have families that say we're willing to use all of our life savings to, you know, put this money on our number one draft, this person to be a nurse, but to not be able to get a state license. So to kind of work on that immigration reform, again, as Michael said, a lot of these conversations are definitely way my pay grade, but we need to continue to make education as accessible as possible, or find funding to be able to support that cost of education.
Great. I think I would add there's so much amazing work going on at the local level, and I think there's so many models out there, and maybe if they just could take some time to look at those and understand what we're doing without the political, there's no political gain, we're just doing it, it's a community effort. And I also think that kind of going along the same lines, so much of these processes and the application process and financial aid is so complicated. It's so hard for anyone to navigate through. And so many of our students, their families is too overwhelming. They don't even know where to start. And so trying to find a way to simplify that and make it obtainable.
Okay, that was a macro question. Now I'm going to ask a micro question. As you know, this ends our series this summer, and most folks will go home tonight. Maybe they'll eat a little more. Maybe they'll watch a little TV. They'll go to bed. Tomorrow morning, they're going to get up, and because, and I say this with all sincerity, since this is such a great group, many of them are going to think tomorrow morning, yeah, but what can I do today, tomorrow, next week here where I live to make a difference. What's your advice to them?
Well, I'll start and say I see several faces out there that are already working with our program, and we're so grateful. We live in such an amazing community, and we're so blessed. Our program is not funded through Furman. Our program is funded through an endowment, a foundation, an anonymous donor, grants, community support, sponsors. And so we really depend on that. But there's so many ways to get involved with us. You know, we have opportunities for college buddies. You know, our freshmen in college, we identify someone in the community to be a college buddy to that student. Also, we're trying to expose our students to different career opportunities. So we try to match students with career mentors. We also have events that we like to invite speakers to come to. We have lunch and learn. So we love to expose our students to what's out there. So a lot of times, I mean, there's such a wealth of knowledge and experience in this room. So just to give back, it's amazing what that does for our students. And we've had some beautiful partnerships with Ollie. And it's just such a love to see that intergenerational relationship grow from both sides. And so, of course, there's the financial support, but there's also the time that I think the students truly appreciate. So there's definitely ways. We would love to have you involved. You can contact me directly, or we have a website with a volunteer application. So, we couldn't do it without the village's support from our community.
Yes, short term, obviously, we're always looking for, colleges are always looking for scholarship opportunities or to raise money to provide people with some help to go to school. Big picture, have conversations with your local congressman and ask, you know, what are we doing to ensure that these young people can go to college? We have such a, like I said, talented workforce. We talk about, you know, we need a skilled workforce. Well, we have it here. They speak several languages already, and they're only 18. and they're very smart, but they need to get trained. And so what can we do to eliminate those barriers? So a lot of states, like in California, are very innovative and got some things going on. Our state got a lot of work to do, but we are doing a lot of good things. But we have a lot of work to do. So to have conversations with your local congressman.
Every cause needs a champion, preferably more than one. The next step for me in trying to bring this effort to offer our post-secondary education within the walls of prisons is to connect with state officials, one of whom Brian Sterling spoke here last summer, and the other is one of your senators, Mike Fair. When that time comes, I understand you're going to send out email addresses for us in case people want to contact us. When that time comes, I will need people like Senator Fair, Senator Malloy from Columbia, who led the commission that produced some of the incredibly good reforms that have been taking place in corrections in South Carolina since 2010. People like that who can influence their fellow legislators. There's a law in South Carolina, for example, that says the Department of Corrections cannot use its funds for tuition. That's crazy. You know, they're going to have recidivism rates forever until they figure out a way to make incarceration a productive experience. If you go back the way you came in, plus now you have a record, how in the hell are you going to get a job? Mm-hmm. It can't happen. You've got to create an environment where this is a second opportunity for you, you know. And for some, it's a first opportunity. Half of the people incarcerated do not have a high school degree. So their education is still underway. And hopefully the time they spend, which on average is about 4.5 years, will give them that opportunity. And the evidence shows, even in South Carolina, where they have other kinds of programs, including one in which the transitional program that Greenville Tech's involved, they have demonstrated that active engagement in something productive while in prison reduces the chances of their going back. But you can do that. You can influence your legislators. Don't do it before the election. Corrections is not a popular thing to put on your campaign poster.
And I would just say, from the Medical Experience Academy perspective, it is a community program. We get tremendous support from the community. So if you're in any way interested or just curious about it, you'll have our email addresses, as we mentioned. There's a tremendous amount of information on the website. We would love for you to reach out to us. And I'll put another name in the room, Dr. Eli Hesterman, who works with me every day. He's over at GHS, actually 3 days a week, who is a Furman faculty but leading some initiatives here. So he will be easy to find as well. But we need your talent, and the wisdom that you have is tremendous to these young people. You could be tremendous role models. So I would just say, reach out. I mean, that we're hungry for that. Okay.
Well, I want to take this opportunity to give us a chance to thank our snapshot speakers once again. I saw some of you taking notes during that last question, so they will expect to see you tomorrow morning. Is this true? I also want to take one last chance to thank both the Riley Institute and Ollie for yet again providing an enormously rich intellectual and socially meaningful experience. Not just because this is the community I live in, but there are very few communities that can host something like this, not least sort of in the middle of summer. I was asked as a final note to offer maybe a sentence or two in closing. I have nothing profound to add. I certainly have nothing that can compare with what you've heard this evening or in the previous two sections. But I'd like to share two thoughts or observations with you. One comes from my very first year teaching. I taught at a school in the Deep South. It was unair-conditioned. I did not have a classroom. I pushed a cart from class to class, except for the portable in which one of my classes was taught, and you can't get a cart down and up stairs. And halfway through that first year, the social studies department ran out of money, and the principal told us, we ran out of paper, and the principal told us the only way we could get more paper is that if we sold candy to the students between classes. Now, I ask you rhetorically, what message did that send to the students in that school about the value that was being placed on their education? And I also ask you, how many of those children would think teaching was an honorable profession to pursue under those circumstances? Second observation, a little more upbeat. During this series, I managed to read Robert Putnam's latest book. Robert Putnam is a well-known, highly regarded sociologist at Harvard, known mostly through his extremely influential book, Bowling Alone. But his latest book, probably his last book, given his age and his career trajectory. The subtitle of that book, which I read during this series, the subtitle is The American Dream in Crisis. But it's what comes before that that I think is most important. The full title of his book is Our Kids, The American Dream in Crisis. And what I would submit to you is the most important word in that title is the word our. He did not title his book Greenville's Kids, Baltimore's kids, Miami's kids. His book is Our Kids. And by extrapolation, what that means is the next time we hear about the kids in Miami or Baltimore or Greenville, our immediate, compassionate, and heartfelt response should be, oh, they're talking about our kids. It's been a marvelous opportunity for me to be involved in this program. I hope that this has inspired many interesting and fulfilling and stimulating conversations. We wish you a wonderful rest of the summer. Thank you.